I would like to look at Psalm 46 with you. So let me read it to you. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the sea, though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar. Kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice and the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done. The desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, "Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted on the earth." The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. A prayer. Dear Lord, you who wrote the Psalms through your servants, interpret them to us now, we pray. In Jesus' name, Amen. Would you agree with this statement? To live with fear is a devastating way to live. All the time you feel that whatever can go wrong will go wrong. I read recently that fear weakens our immune system and can cause cardiovascular damage, gastrointestinal problems such as ulcers and irritable bowel syndrome, and decreased fertility. It can lead to accelerated aging and even premature death. That's pretty devastating, isn't it? I wonder if you've ever been somewhere while there was an earthquake. Daphne and I were once in Mexico when the earth shook. It's a pretty scary feeling, as everything around you shudders and you wonder if the buildings and roads will collapse. We see such devastation on our TV screens and it looks terrifying. Indeed, if you live on a fault line, you must always live with that sense of fear. Well, here in Psalm 46, the ground shakes. Look with me at the second sentence, the second verse, as that we call it. The earth gives way and the mountains fall into the sea. Its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. That's a picture of the devastation of an earthquake, isn't it? And life is really fearful. Now, for some of us, we live our life out of fear. Maybe it's not the fear of an earthquake, but it's the fear of making a mistake, or the fear of something going wrong, or the fear of the world collapsing all around you. How then do we handle fear? Where do we go as a safe place to hide? And the psalmist is quite clear. He says that we are to flee to God. Look how he starts again at 1. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Even though the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, even though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with surging. God is our refuge and strength, and therefore we will not fear. And he himself lives in safety. At verse 4, there is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Yes, God is safe and secure in his holy city. And this song portrays God as the solid one. God as the solid one. That's the big theme of the song. He's the rock of all rocks, our refuge and strength, our ever-present help in times of trouble. Look at all the sentences that start with God. Look at verse 5. God is within her, the holy city. She will not fall. God will help her at break of day. Or look at the refrain at 7 and 11. The Lord Almighty is with us. That's God and his army, God and his heavenly hosts, the big boulder. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Or look at the eyes in verse 10. Be still and know that I, God, am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted on the earth. All the eyes. I am God. I'll be exalted. It's a God-focused song, isn't it? By the way, that's probably how all good praise songs should be. Songs of praise and thanksgiving should be God-centred, shouldn't they? But there is a consequence to God's stability, his solidness. It's the therefore in verse 2. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. So whatever happens around us, there is a secure and safe place to go. That's what the song is all about. God is solid. And because of that, it is possible that we do not need to fear. Now, secondly, this solid God is also safe. God is safe. Yes, it's true. The world has its earthquakes and floods. We saw that, didn't we, in 2 and 3. There's instability in the nations, verse 6. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice and the earth melts. But there is one safe place for us to go. There is one refuge. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. You see, for all this earth's troubles, God is the one stability. God is in control. We saw his power in nature, 1 to 3. We see him sitting in his holy city, a very beautiful and well-watered place, his eternal home. And that doesn't mean that God is removed from us, sitting somewhere up high, whilst he's at home up there and we're toiling away down below here. No, the fact that God has a city means that there is a safe place to go, to run to. And the Bible loves this holy city. It describes the holy city in Revelation chapter 22. Worth turning. Revelation 22 and the first 5 verses. You got it? Last book of the Bible. Revelation 22. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more light. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of the sun, for the Lord God will give them light, and they will reign for ever and ever. God's at home in his eternal city. And the water of life means it's a living city, just like the river watering the Garden of Eden. The city of God is the eternal destiny, not only for God, but for his people too. It's there that they can live in safety and security. No harm, no enemies. So this city of God is a glorious picture of the future with God's eternal protection. Yes, God is all-powerful in creation. Yes, he is also well secure in his eternal city. And therefore, he has sovereign power over the world. Come back to Psalm 46 and look at verse 9. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns a shield with fire. The problem is that this earth is wild. You see, however rebellious the people are, there are forces of chaos, as Christopher Ashe puts it, here on earth. And yet we are not independent of the sovereign creator. He's called the Lord Almighty, the Lord with unbeatable armies. He's the one who is with us. You see, when the troubles come, according to the end of verse 6, he lifts his voice. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall, but he lifts his voice. And when he does that, the earth melts. It jumps to his word. It responds to him. Melts here probably means goes into chaos and disaster. His hand is still on it. It's a bit like the flood in Noah's day. The chaos that was caused by the flood waters was God's work. It was his judgment on the world. See, we live in a world that is under the judgment of God. It's been so ever since Adam acted independently and rebelled. So where is the safe place to hide? Where can we go and find a refuge? Well, it's not in this world, is it? It must be in his city, in his holy place. We hide ourselves in him. Think how Jesus transformed the chaotic sea into a calm. Think how Jesus took disease and cured it. Think how powerful Jesus was, and yet how safe he is. Safety from judgment is found in Christ. That's where the waters of chaos are transformed into life-giving waters of the river of life. Did you notice that in verse 4? Look at the beginning of 4. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. Yes, and since the city is glad to have such living water, we should be also, shouldn't we? Well, up to verse 7, we have seen the facts about God and his great power. God is solid and God is safe. But from 8 onwards, the theme changes. It moves from God to us. Here there is a call on the actions we need to take. Or putting the two together, when we are confronted with the power and greatness of God, we're expected to make a response. So verse 8 starts off the response. Come, see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. And then comes the refrain. The Lord Almighty is with us, the God of Jacob is our fortress. And that's repeated again at 11. It almost holds together 8 to 10 between it, this last section. Here's the action we need to take. Why? Because the Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. So therefore we should come and see what the Lord has done. It is this action, if we take it, that will still our fears. So the refrain at 7 and 11 frames the last section, holds it together. With chaos all around us, maybe even within us, the psalmist says, stop, stop. Stop and look. Come. Come, he says. Come and see. Come and see what the Lord has done. 8. The desolations he's brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow, shatters the spear. He burns a shield with fire. Come and look. Stop and look. Now, we've mentioned Noah. Think also, as we look, the holding back of the Red Sea. Think how God didn't let his people starve in the wilderness. Pause. Ask yourself, what has God done in the past? Look at how he put down rebellions against his people. Look at the king he's put on the throne. Read Psalm 2. Stop. Look. That's one of the reasons to read the Old Testament, to see how God acted in history to bring his people into his promised land. It's not their rebelliousness that startles us. That's almost natural. It's God's undeserving, miraculous action that we should marvel at. Come and see what the Lord has done. The desolation he brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the ends of the earth. You see, that tells us that this world is not out of control. It certainly is off balance and out of sync. But God has his hand firmly on the controls. Now surely that stills all our fears, doesn't it? Jesus' control over nature is a wonderful assurance that he is the one to trust. Just stop and look. Come and see what the Lord has done. But secondly, don't only look, stop and think. That's our conclusion, to stop. Be still, he says at verse 10. Be still and know that I am God. Stop. Think. Yes, we stop, we look, and we think, we ponder. Who runs a show here? Who's in charge? Who made this world? Who created the heavens? Who sits above the world and rules it? Who can lift their voice and everyone stops? Even the earth melts at his voice. Who is that? Who is greater than all the nations and all creation put together? Is it not God Almighty? Or as he's called here, the Lord Almighty, the covenant God, the God of armies. If that is who he is, we should stop, think, repent, cease our rebellion if we want God to be our friend. The world is truly a fearful place. But God runs a show. And that's why we will not fear, why we are not to be afraid. Did you know that that phrase, do not be afraid or do not be fearful, is the most frequent phrase uttered by the Lord Jesus? When Martin Luther, who put this psalm to music, when he and his friend Philip Melanchthon were feeling down, they would sing this psalm. It lifted them from their encouragement. It was called A Safe Stronghold, Our God Is Still, set to Ein Festerberg. It helped them gain confidence in God's sovereignty amidst the upheavals of nature and history. But not only did they sing the song, Luther and Melanchthon, but Jesus sang it too. As a good Jewish boy and man, he would have been singing this song from the Jerusalem songbook. He would have known something far worse than earthquakes on earth. He would know about the judgment of God, the wrath of God against all human sin. And he would know that he was sent to do something about it, to avert it, to soak it up, to destroy death. And he would have done so. He did so out of enormous love for you and me. So where is the safe place to run to? To Jesus. Jesus the Redeemer, Jesus the Rescuer, Jesus the Sin Abater. Are you placing your trust in Jesus? And if not, what solid foundation are you building your life on, if any at all? Why not run to Jesus and find eternal security and safety? You see, the Lord God, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus, placed Jesus on his throne in his holy city. Life on earth is really precarious, isn't it? So please run to Jesus for your eternal benefit. You will find he can handle all earthly fears with greater ease and even joy when you trust him. Numerous people have told me over the years that once they started to walk Jesus' ways, once they started to trust him, a real sense of peace overcame them. You see, it is in Jesus that fears are stilled and striving cease. Go on then, trust him. A prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for holding this broken world together. Thank you for your strong, solid hand. We are troubled by all the chaos around us and even within us, and we do need your help. Thank you that Jesus was sent as our rescuer. May we truly trust him with our whole life, we ask. Hold on to us, we pray, and help us walk with you in all the circumstances of life as your Holy Spirit accompanies us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you once again for watching and listening. God bless.